10:05, welcome back to the Chad Easty Show. Final hour of today's program. If you missed my interview earlier with Senator John Cornyn, we've got that up at the KFYO YouTube page. His comments on this impeachment inquiry, you can check that out at YouTube and KFYO on YouTube. We'll also have that up at the KFYO website as well. Joining me next on the program, it's always a pleasure to visit with our good friend Scott Braddock, editor of the Quorum Report. Good morning, Scott. How are you today?
Doing so well, Chad. It is a beautiful day in Austin, Texas. Blue skies, 71 degrees as I'm talking to you live in downtown next to the Texas Capitol.
Well, that's
nice. What is it there?
Yeah.
Is it freezing there?
I think 60 degrees? It's not too bad. It's not too bad.
Yeah, no snow or ice or anything like that.
No, none of that. We don't need any of that this week.
I'll come visit y'all at some point, just not when it's like that.
Yeah, that'll work. Mm-hmm. There's so much to get into, sure. Scott. And I guess we'll start off with the news over the weekend. Mm-hmm. Beto O'Rourke, his campaign for president got all the way up to like 7% at one point. His campaign is over, Scott.
A meteoric rise, but then the fall was like the asteroid in crashing into the earth and leaving just rubble. This has been really, I was trying to think, what is that movie, the Bruce Willis movie? Was it called Meteor or Asteroid? Whatever it was. Armageddon.
Yeah, Armageddon.
Yeah, did not go well. So you know, here you have this guy who set the political world on fire, you know, a year ago, 2 years ago, the congressman from El Paso, comes out of nowhere, out of obscurity. Had you ever heard of Beto O'Rourke before he ran for U.S. Senate? And most people across Texas had not. But suddenly he became a national figure, and he was the person that Democrats were rallying around. And quite a few Republicans took to him as well. Remember, in 2018, there were 500,000 Texas voters who chose O'Rourke, but then also chose Governor Abbott and Glenn Hager for comptroller, et cetera. So there was some discontent among Republicans, I think, with Senator Cruz. And there was a lot of talk after he almost beat him. I mean, and that's a big accomplishment for a Texas Democrat, right, to say you could almost beat a Republican statewide.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really moving the needle. I mean, think just 4 years earlier, you had, Wendy Davis lose by 21 points back in 2014 to Governor Abbott, and all of the Democrats up and down the ballot at the statewide level did about the same. But Beto really sort of brought the Democratic Party up in this state, up with him, you know, rising tide lifts all ships and all that. But his positions on various issues, which was much more moderate in 2018 on the issue of guns, for example. A lot of people had pointed to the interview you did with him when he was on KFYO talking about the idea that he was not, absolutely not interested in taking anybody's guns away. At least that's the way he was talking about it.
Yeah.
To shift from that to saying, hell yes, we'll confiscate your AR-15, your AK-47, and all of that. I think my friend James Henson over at the University of Texas said it really well. It changes his trajectory. Right. I mean, other people would just say it means that he's toast in Texas. Some of the positions that he was taking on the campaign trail, trying to be in that far left lane in a crowded field running for president, doesn't exactly position him to come back here and run for the U.S. Senate. But as I said over the weekend online and on social media, I would take any pronouncements that he won't run with a grain of salt. I honestly don't expect him to run, Chad. But I wouldn't be shocked either if he jumped in and said, look, you know, people are asking me to do this. It's very interesting. He was occupying a difficult position in the race for the White House. He wanted to be the Texas candidate, right? He was up against Castro, Julian Castro, who's also running and is still in the race, by the way.
What?
He was trying to, well, that's what I hear.
Julian Castro is still in this thing?
Yes, sir. And with Beto out, who would have expected that?
Wow.
Give the man some credit. He's still there. And Beto's not. By the way, mainstream media really likes to cover Beto, and Castro struggles for any kind of coverage. So I would give Castro some credit for still being there. But he was trying to assert that he was the Texas candidate, right? Beto was trying to do that. And he was in an interesting position. I say it that way because he had most Texas Democrats wanting him to come back and run for Senate instead. There was a poll earlier this year and I pointed at this over the weekend too, that showed that 60% of Texas Democrats thought he should not be running for the White House and instead should be running for the U.S. Senate. So the constituency he was hoping for, that Beto was hoping to kind of keep him competitive in this deal, the Texas Democratic voter base, they didn't even want him to be running for the thing he was running for, right? I mean, they wanted him to be running for U.S. Senate. So while he was staking out these far-left positions and trying to assert that he was the Texas candidate, none of that was going well. His polls didn't look all that great, and he was running out of money when he had been such a prolific fundraiser before. And on Friday, just had to pull the plug and say, this is not working out.
Yeah, and listen, I'm with you. I don't think that he runs for the Senate seat. I think if he were to run against John Cornyn, he would get smoked. I mean, the positions that he has taken now, you could maybe make the argument if the, old Beto O'Rourke, the Beto O'Rourke who ran against Cruz, maybe he could give Cornyn a run for his money. The new O'Rourke, I don't see how he wins over any type of Republican support. And even some Democrats may get turned off by the gun confiscation talk. And let's not forget about the tax exempt status of churches. Cornyn would love to run some ads on that one against Beto O'Rourke.
Yeah, you can see the ads now. God and guns, and Beto is against both. That's the way the RNC ads would run, and the Senate Republican leadership PAC would do the same sort of thing. Talking about that, Cornyn wouldn't even have to do it himself, probably.
Yeah,
he'd have allied organizations that would be able to say that. And I would say, in fairness to Beto on the gun issue, it is possible that someone has a tragedy like what happened in El Paso, this mass shooting, horrific, happens in their hometown, and it stiffens their position on the issue. He may say, because of that, I now do believe that some of these weapons should be confiscated. But the political reality is that probably does not fly in Texas.
Yeah. Now, let's take a look at that Democrat primary race, because while O'Rourke is probably not going to jump into it, his positions have become a little bit of an issue in that race. MJ Hager came out and said, well, that's an idea that Beto has, but it's not one that's going to win. And I'm not going to take that position. She was blasted by Chris Bell and some other Democrats who are running in that race. And Scott, still nobody knows who any of these people are who are trying to win the Democrat nomination.
Right. You've got Chris Bell, who was a congressman back in the day from Houston. He was also on city council. MJ Hager, who ran for Congress. You've got Royce West, who is a Democratic senator from Dallas. You got Amanda Edwards, who's a councilwoman in Houston. And you look at these folks that just don't have a statewide profile. Now, there's still time for them to build that up. I don't know that their fundraising is going well enough to be able to make that happen. But Texas is such a challenge for someone when they're running statewide. I was talking to a friend of mine who was a consultant on a statewide campaign years and years ago, going back to about 2006. And they were saying, yes, it's huge. Yes, it's a big place. But people don't understand how big politically Texas is. This consultant was telling me that they had their candidate do town halls and radio interviews and TV interviews, did a media blitz, Chad, for about 2 weeks all across the state. And, of course, this is back before social media had the same kind of impact. And, of course, that's what helped Beto a lot, to raise his name ID everywhere, doing those Facebook Lives all the time. No matter what he was doing, either he was getting the flu shot or just talking to people in his hotel room or whatever. But they didn't have that back then. But still, this person was just crisscrossing the state, barnstorming for 2 weeks. And after doing that, their name ID at the beginning of the 2 weeks compared to the end of the 2 weeks, it had gone up 0.5%.
Wow.
Just a huge challenge.
Yeah, it is. And it's a big state and an expensive state. Let's talk about some other races that are going on in Texas. That is the presidential race. New poll out shows that no Democrats right now are going to beat Trump in Texas.
And not surprising, although I would say one thing is concerning for the president, which is in these head-to-head matchups, whether it's Joe Biden, Warren, Sanders, O'Rourke, and this poll was done before O'Rourke had dropped out, in fairness to the pollsters over at the University of Texas, and Castro, the president is not above 50 in any of these polls, so being underwater is a little bit concerning for the person who should handily win in a Republican state. But Trump against Biden, he wins 46-39. Trump against Warren, it's 46-39. same thing. Against Sanders, it's 45-40, 47-41 against the now deposed O'Rourke, and Castro coming in at 46-33. So no matter who they nominate, if the election was today, Trump, of course, is the odds-on favorite. And that shouldn't surprise anybody. I mean, I think that the president has a pretty good grip on Texas. And the fact is that his campaign is taking it seriously, Chad, no matter what they say. Remember, when you were at the rally in Dallas, the president was saying, what, that Texas is not in play. You know, there's no question. We're rock-solid Republican here in Texas. And so he's not worried about it. But his campaign, the way they're running it and some of the planning that they're doing indicates the opposite, that they are at least taking it seriously. Not that they think they're going to lose, but, you know, anytime Republicans have to expend resources in Texas, that's not a good thing because they should be spending money in other places that are, you know, more questionable. Some of those swing states that we talk about a lot, like Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, Florida, et cetera. And so, you know, they don't want to spend millions of dollars here because those dollars go a lot further in smaller states. And the president has, you know, some spending planned here. And he also has a plan to be here a lot. You know, the president has been here, I think, more than any other state that he carried. He's been in Texas a lot, more than any other state where he, you know, has a property where he lives. He doesn't have a, there's no Trump Tower, Dallas, or Houston just yet.
Yeah.
But so he doesn't have any property here, and he's been here a lot. And we expect him to continue to come to Texas a lot to try to shore up his support.
Yeah, no. When he was in Dallas, Scott, I heard discussion that there would be at least one more stop in Texas, maybe two more stops before Election Day, mm-hmm. and we're a year out. So I would expect more of that. And also, listen, I've got the RNC coming on the show weekly, and while mm-hmm. I love it, it does show they're taking Texas seriously. they're paying yes. attention to Absolutely. This state. Let's talk about the another ramification of the election, as that is the GOP majority in the Texas mm-hmm. House. There have been some, and I think you and I discussed this maybe last week, mm-hmm. who have wondered, can Speaker Dennis Bonin continue to raise money and help the Republicans that he wants to help out in the Texas House? That was the plan all along, that yeah. he was going to fundraise and hand out money. Can he continue to do that? Scott, I'm hearing there may be some other plans now, or maybe the, you know, something else is in the works here.
Well, there's some stuff cooking. There was a sort of secret meeting last week. Texans for Lawsuit Reform, the Associated Republicans of Texas, two allied organizations of Texas House members who are Republicans, also getting together with the top strategist for Governor Abbott behind closed doors. You've heard of Dave Carney, of course, who runs the campaigns for the governor. And they were just sort of huddling to try to figure out what's the plan now to try to keep a Republican majority in the Texas House. So this is a huge question after the Speaker had to step aside, but not down just yet. And I know there's some grassroots activists who think he ought to just go ahead and resign rather than just saying he's not going to run because of the scandal. And by the way, you mentioned the RNC. I have heard some of my reporting suggest that Lieutenant Governor Patrick is the one sort of rattling the trees, you know, shaking the trees with the RNC and above that, even with the White House, to say this Bonin thing isn't really an issue with voters, but it's a distraction
right.
for Republicans. You know, that's probably the fair way to say it. So these Republicans got together in a closed-door meeting last week, and my reporting was from sources who were in the room, who said that, one, they did not want to directly talk about what had happened with the Speaker, that the Speaker basically needs some time to cool off before anybody talks to him about what he's going to do with the $3 million that he has in a PAC that was supposed to go toward backing up Republicans in their elections, right? When people wrote those checks to Bonin, they're not just giving them to him. It's to the overall effort to help elect Republican candidates. But, you know, the way the rules are, Chad, he doesn't really have to do that with the money now. That is a question out there. I mean, this would be extreme, but I could imagine that, you know, someday down at Brazosport College in his district, there might be a $3 million Dennis Bonin building that he ends up using for that money for. But, you know, for backing up Republicans, these other groups have to figure out how they're going to do that. Interesting number out of this, Carney, that strategist for Governor Abbott, told this group that there are 33 Texas House seats that he thinks are in play. Mm. Some people read that and thought that's 33 that Democrats could pick up, but that's not what he means. What he means is that there are those freshman Democrats, 12 of them, who were elected in 2018, who maybe Republicans could take some of those seats back. I think there's at least one in the Houston area and one in the Austin area that are probably good candidates for that and will certainly be targeted. But there are also, a lot of seats in the Houston and Dallas suburbs that will probably be in play, for the Democrats to potentially pick up in 2020, and potentially, certainly at least 9 or 10 of them that would give the Democrats the majority. So Republicans are trying to go on some offense here, take some of those seats back. I don't think they can get much more than 2 of them, Chad. If Carney thinks that they can take all 12 of those back, I think he'd be optimistic. But look, the Democrats only have to pick up 9 seats to take the majority in the House. Republicans don't want that, and so they're trying to figure out how to circle the wagons when they do have a vacuum of leadership because the Speaker is now toxic.
Scott Braddock, editor of Quorum Report. We're up against it. We got to get going. Scott, tell folks what they can find at the very great website, quorumreport.com.
We'll be tracking these special elections tomorrow. I know that people are very interested in some of the propositions, including the one on income taxes. There's also 3 special elections across the state, including one in the Houston suburbs that may serve as sort of a bellwether for where we're headed with the elections we were just talking about.
Yeah.
We'll have all the results for you and analysis at quorumreport.com.
Excellent. As always, Scott, appreciate your time, and we'll visit again next week.
Thanks, my friend. Talk soon.
Have a good one. That's Scott Braddock, editor, Quorum Report.